If I speak with tongues and in languages I have not known, I am become a sound of brass, and taken of silver. And if I have the gift of prophecy, instead of all mysteries and all knowledge, if I have all faith so that I can remove mountains, I have not love, none. And though I bestow all my goods to be, and though I give my body to be burned, I have not love, I have none. Love suffers long, and is kind. Love envies not. Love abundance not itself, is not talked of. Do not behave itself unseemly. Seek is not own, not easily provoked. Think is no evil. Love rejoices, not in the angry, but rejoice in the truth. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. And now, by faith, hope, and love, these three, the greatest of all, is love.
God be your God, great Jehovah, pilgrim through this barren land. God be your God, great Jehovah.
Let us bow. Lord, gracious and mighty Lord, we come to you today with thanksgiving in our hearts. Heavenly Father, we want to thank you, thank you, thank you. Heavenly Father. Heavenly Father, thank you for the best new year ever. Because you have allowed us another year to praise your name. Father, help us cherish each moment in chapter of life. Lord, help us to listen with open hearts, to tear down the strongholds in our lives, and to make choices that please you. Help us to love one another. Remind me today, Father, that ours, short or long, are a gift from you. Show me how to use them in your praise. Lord, we come to you with heavy hearts because of the situations that's going on in our world, Heavenly Father. Heavenly Father, we pray for our leaders. Heavenly Father, even though they think they're doing right, Heavenly Father, they do not know, especially if they don't know you. Because, Heavenly Father, you are all-knowing, all-doing. And all the amount of things that they're doing don't mean anything if they don't have you in their hearts. Lord, let me rejoice in you always. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Walk around, frowned up all the time.
church covenant, having been led, we believe by the Spirit of God to receive the Lord Jesus Christ as our Savior. And on profession of our faith, having been baptized in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, we do now in the presence of God and this assembly, both sovereignly and joyfully and in true covenant with one another, as one body in Christ.
In days, therefore, by the aid of the Holy Spirit, to walk together in Christian love, to strive for the advancement of His church, in knowledge, holiness, and honor, to promote His prosperity and spirituality, to sustain His worship, holiness, discipline, and doctrines, to endure the children living in their heritage, to support the mission, in the sense of the church, the relief of the poor, and to spread the gospel among all nations.
We are also engaged to maintain family and secret devotion. Educate our children, seek the salvation of our kingdoms and acquaintance, walk circumspectly in the world, to be just in our dealing, faithful in our engagement, explore in our deportment, toward all chapter, backbite, and excessive anger. To stand firm in the sale of and use of destruction drugs or intoxicating drinks as a beverage, to shun pornography, to be zealous in our efforts to advance the kingdom of our Savior.
We pray that we engage to watch over one another in brotherly love, to remember one another in prayer, to aid one another in sickness and distress, to cultivate
Christian courtesy and speech, to be slow to take advance, always ready for every nation, and mindful of the world. Thank you. Jesus. Amen.
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 Good morning.
Good morning.
These are your announcements. The pastor supports Super Bowl dinner. They're going to have smoked brisket, smoked chicken, don't pass me by potato salad, seasoned cabbage. Let me see what else they got on here. Cornbread. Pinto beans. Now, I've never had that, but it sounds good. The vegetable plates are $7, and the one meat plate is $8. If you would like to place your orders ahead of time, and then just go by and pick them up, that would be wonderful. Now, the other announcement, that's the only announcement. Oh, the hefty plates are $10. Hefty plates, that's a lot of food. $10. Now, you know why I'm up here giving this announcement? It's because of the church anniversary.
Amen.
110th anniversary.
Amen.
Next Sunday. But before next Sunday, we have game night on next Saturday. From 3 to 7.
Amen.
On that night, we're going to just have ourselves a good time. Pastor will probably be here too. He's a little loud. You know, I told you some loud people in this church. I'm just not going up. But we're going to have fun. And we would like to see each and every one of you. I'm looking at everybody out here. And you know, I know just about everybody in the church. So I'll know if you don't come. Now we're down to the real part. That's the church anniversary. Our goal is $110 for that Sunday. And we'd like to pack the pews. We didn't get a lot of people with those cards coming back to invite our former guest. But you know who they are. Invite some of your family members. They haven't been here in a long time. We'd love to see them and have them to come out on next Sunday to our church anniversary. That's 110 years is a long time. And so if we've been in existence that long, we should be excited about our church anniversary. I'm excited. I'm always excited when I get up here to make these announcements to you. And I try to make them real, real clear. So nobody can say that they don't know what's going on.
Amen.
So if you have any kind of questions, let us know.
Amen.
Pack the pews next Sunday. Let's see how many rows we can have full. We got this row with Miss Sister Joyce. It's just about all empty. You gonna pack the pews next? She's gonna pack the pews with her row.
Amen.
You do the same. I'll see you next Saturday and then again next Sunday. Thank you.
Amen.
They have free canned goods. Boy, we doing free. We got free canned goods. They say after church. So in the fellowship hall, go get you some free canned goods and cook them. And they call me. I'll cook. Call me. Thank you.
Especially when you're writing checks or if you're signing any particular document,
sure to make, write all four of the digits. You know, we got a whole 100 years, well, another decade, I guess, at least, that you have to be careful. And so just be mindful of that. Just writing a check, or you sign a document, be sure to write out the entire 4 digits, 2020, because it's very easily altered. I will bring you up to date on some of the announcements. I do want to emphasize how important it is for our church anniversary coming up. Sister Trumbull is already talking about it, but 110 years is not anything to take lightly.
Amen.
I say this all the time. There's been a whole lot of entities, businesses, things of that nature that has come and gone in that length of time. But God saw fit to lead this church, which is not a mega church by any stretch of the imagination. But he's seen fit to keep us and bring us 110 years. And so we hope that that you are as proud of this as we are, that you will encourage and invite people to come out to help us celebrate. I'm pleased that they have planned an activity for us to come out and have fun the night before we celebrate this 110 years. We are asking each one of our members to make a contribution of $110. But if you can't do that, just do what you can. If you can't do any of it, just be here. Supported with your presence and with your prayers. Today we're going to be installing our offices for this year. And when it's time for the message, we would like all of our officers, if you're in the choir stand, to come out and take a seat in the audience to my left and your right. You're seated in the audience. But we'd like to have all of our officers to assemble together in one location. It's time to turn off. Most of us. But now it's time for us to hit the ground running. And so we want to encourage all of our ministries, our ministry leaders, you would begin to hold your regular meetings. And for those of you who are part of these ministries, for you to come out and be in attendance. Now, the rest of the announcements that I have has to do with those who have been ill, or those who are ill, and those who have lost loved ones. But before I do that, this evening at the Cotton Bowl, Texas A&M and the University of Texas will be engaged in a hockey game. There's hockey ice that has been set up in the Cotton Bowl. They just completed the playoffs for the National Hockey Association. And since the ice is still there, these two schools are going to face one another. And we have free passes. For those of you who have never attended a hockey game in person, like me, I've watched it on TV while I was changing channels. But I always use this as an opportunity to enlighten me on the game. And since there's no charge for parking, I think that maybe a hot dog and a Coke that will be given out this afternoon at 5 o'clock. Everything is free. If you'd like to participate, you can have a flyer. We'll let a car load in. But if you want to get refreshments and things like that, you'll have to have a flyer. The flyer is your ticket. So please see Sister Parish. Raise your hand, Sister Deborah. She will have flyers or will make them available at the end of service. And if you do plan to attend, pick up a flyer. Now, let me me get to this list of people that we need to pray for. Like for us to pray for Reverend Tony Evans. He, his wife passed away, and she's going to be funeralized, my understanding, tomorrow by the Oakland Bible Fellowship. And we ask that you would keep Dr. Evans and his family and the church family in your prayers. Sister Donna Vining's mother passed away, and her mother was a member here for a short period of time, but funeral services will be here at the church on Saturday at 11 o'clock. But I'd like for you to keep Donna and Troy and the rest of the family lifted up in your prayers. Sister Clara O'Halley, who is a member of Great Chapel Baptist Church, they fellowship with us quite often down through the years, and she was president, served as president of our missionary work in the District Association of Women's Auxiliary. Her husband passed away, and he is going to be funeralized on Saturday at Griggs Chapel Baptist Church at 11 o'clock. We ask that you would keep them in your prayers. Pray for Sister Anna Williams. She was readmitted to the hospital this week. It's my understanding that she may be released to go home today. Keep her in your prayers. Thank you for praying for Sister Lee Young. We'll continue to pray for her. She's been released from the hospital to a rehab location, but she has been very ill. We ask that you keep her in your prayers. Nancy Simmons, I don't know how many of you remember Nancy. Nancy passed away this past week, and the funeral services are pending. I don't have that information. Does anybody know? I know they were looking at having her service Thursday, but I'm not sure of where. Okay, it's going to be Thursday. And so we ask that you would keep Nancy's family in your prayers. Reverend E.D. Ingram, our former moderator, lost a daughter, and she was funeralized on yesterday. And so we ask that you would keep the Ingram family in your prayers. Now, if there are any other announcements, we will bring them to you as we proceed in our service. Let's celebrate today.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. We're here because the Lord allowed us to cross the threshold of another decade. See another year. And I'm glad about it.
Amen.
And you ought to be too.
Amen.
My prayer was that, Lord, if you're not gonna be with us, don't let us cross over.
Amen.
He let us cross over, so that means he's with us.
Amen.
So we need to make a joyful noise at this place today. Thank you so much. Our greeters are now going to come and give us our formal greeting.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Give it all honor and glory to my Heavenly Father, Jesus Christ, and to the shepherd of this house, Pastor Parish, and to the First Lady Parish, to the ministers, the choir, and my co-laborers, the greeters. With all of our first-time visitors, please stand and remain standing. Kristen, you don't have no visitor? Okay, so let me say, any visitor, please stand, remain standing. On behalf of my pastor and first lady, I would like to welcome you to our place of worship. Please join in and worship the Lord with us. And if by chance you're here today and unsure of where your life is headed, maybe falling down, wondering about who loves you and who doesn't. I remember a song years ago on the movie Urban Cowboy. Anybody about my age remember that movie? there was a song called Looking for Love. And love in all the wrong places, looking for love in too many places, searching her eyes, looking for traces of what I'm dreaming of, hoping to find a friend and a lover. I bless the day I discover another heart looking for love. Well, if that's you, look no more. The word of God says in Jeremiah 31:3, yea, I love you with an everlasting love. Therefore, with loving kindness have I drawn thee. God's spirit has drawn you, no more searching and trying to figure it out on your own. He is your helper. I welcome you to our church and thank you for coming. Church, please love on our visitor and on one another. God bless you.
Churches order to the doctrine that we may be about our Father's business. This is the time that the Lord has given us an opportunity to come together and worship. Worship Him with our tithes and offering and a portion of what He has blessed us with. Let us pray. Father God, we thank You for Your love, Your mercy, and Your grace. We thank You, Father, that You gave the very best to all mankind, that whosoever believes in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. We thank You, Father, that we have another opportunity to worship You with a portion of what You have blessed us with. Father, You only ask for 10% and a little more to give, not greatly all necessity. But You told us in Your word that You love a pure cheerful gift. Yes, our blessings upon the gift that we receive and those that give it. We pray by Son Jesus' name.
Amen. Thank you.
doing good works men and women would look on us and give us the praise. That they would glorify God who made us and who created us. And so you can't take this matter of time frivolously. Amen. We waste time, which is something that's irreplaceable. I wish that I could go back and get yesterday back. I wish I could get go back to 1992, 1960. I'm going to lose some of you. Some of you wasn't even around. But I wish I could go back to 1960.
Yes.
Amen. 1953. If I could go back to but if I could go back that far, I would do things altogether differently, especially if I was armed with the knowledge that I have now. Just imagine, what kind of person would you be if you could go back when you were in high school, elementary school, and you knew what you know now? Would you do some things differently? I tend to think so. I know that I would. I would be a different person. And I don't know that I would be happier, because a lot of the things that we think that we would do, we think that it would bring us happiness, but in reality, it wouldn't. One of the first things that we all thought about when you said if you could go back, we would all be rich. But when you look at it, money does not bring you happiness. And so that ought to tell us something. What's the most important things out there? And strive to accomplish those things. Because that's what makes life fulfilling. That's what makes our lives rewarding. If we can do those things that are important. There have been very few people that I've seen that coming to the end of their life that look at me and say, Reverend, you know what? I wish I had made more money. Those are not some of the things that people focus on and think about, especially at the time, you know, time like, you know, that we're living in. And so you can start now to making the rest of today different than it would have been if you were focused on the things that are most important to you. Your relationships. You know, how are you getting along with your spouse if you're married? If you're not married, how are you getting along with your special friend if you have one? If you don't have a special friend, how are you getting along? How are you interacting with your family? Because those are the things that's important. One of the things that I look at, especially when I look at the world that we live in today, one of the things that I have put at the top of my list, I've started praying for my grandchildren. And for my great-grandchildren. The ones that I'm going to leave behind. What kind of world are they going to grow up in? What's going to be happening around them? What is going to school going to be like for my great-grandson, great-granddaughter that I have not met? May not get the opportunity to meet. Are they gonna still be dodging bullets? You know, what is it gonna be like? Are we going to all have to board ourselves up and create forts around our houses because we are afraid to leave because people have just gone stark raving mad in Texas and join them in that process and allow everybody that wants to have a gun to have a gun, to carry a gun, and then wonder why murders are up? Isn't that crazy? We live in a crazy world. When people are doing things to exacerbate the problem and then wonder why the problem won't go away. I was having a conversation with someone yesterday and my memory's gotten so bad I can't remember who I was talking to. It was probably my brother. We rode to Fort Worth to his funeral yesterday. And we were talking about, just talking about how bad things really are. And it occurred to me that, we used to wouldn't even think twice about bringing firearms to church. But we saw just this past week, where if it hadn't been for somebody that had a firearm, a lot more people would have been hurt. And what it was. And we've got to do something about it. We all have a responsibility. We all have a role to play. And it starts with us working on ourselves. If we can just straighten ourselves out, then maybe that would encourage somebody else to straighten themselves or to conduct themselves better. Well, our message today, the title of it is Reporting or Presenting Ourselves for Duty. Another way to look at that, and that is reporting for duty. Now, I was in the Army, that was a real big thing. We had to report for service. And if you would open your Bibles to Romans chapter 12, we're going to,
that's okay,
brother. I'm not breathing properly, so it thinks that I have kicked the bucket. That's why it's deep, Mike. We'll get on the same page here in a minute. I have listed verses 1 and 2, but if you will allow me, I think I want to read a little further than that. I'm reading from the NIV translation. Romans chapter 12, beginning at verse 1. Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as living sacrifices, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Verse 2. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and to approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. Verse 3. For by the grace given me, I say to every one of you, do not think of yourself more highly than you are, but rather think of yourself with sober judgment in accordance with the faith God has distributed to each of you. For just as each of us has one body with many members, and these members do not all have the same function, so in Christ, we, though many, form one body, and each member belongs to all the others. We have different gifts according to the grace given to each of us. If your gift is prophesying, then prophesy in accordance with your faith. If it is serving, then serve. If it is teaching, then teach. If it is encouraging, then encourage. If it is given to, if it is giving, then give. Generously. If it is to lead, do it diligently. And if it is to show mercy, do it cheerfully. I'm going to stop there. I think that's enough for us to focus on right there. Paul is writing, and he begins this by saying therefore. And therefore is transitioning from what he has said in the previous 11 chapters. And these 11 chapters he has covered a multitude of things. But one of the things that he focused on, and I won't spend a lot of time talking about all the other things, but one of the things that he really points out, and that is, all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. In other words, we've all sinned, and none of us deserve God's mercy. None of us deserve His grace. I heard somebody say, at the foot of the cross, the ground is level. There's nobody that stands on a higher plane than anybody else. And why is that? Because we all are sinners. Now some of us are good at pretending that we never sin and are pretty convinced. But just the other day, the Pope had to apologize. I don't know if you saw that or not, but I did. And he had to admit, but listen, I have my shortcomings. And sometimes I can be very impatient. All that sin. And we need to let that soak in. And in that light, we're no better than the person that spent all night under the bridge. In that instance, we're no greater than the drunkard that spent all of their money getting drunk this weekend. I'm told that Martin Luther that he passed by a drunk that was laying in a ditch, and he said, "Go out." In other words, if it wasn't for God's grace, I would be just as filthy, just as drunk, just as dirty as that man that we just saw. And so we have to get over ourselves. And we have to understand that we're no better than anybody else, and it was not for the grace of God that reached down and plucked me out and saved my soul. That I would be just as bad off as those people that we pass on the street. And so he said, because of God's mercy, and a lot of people say that it's a cliche I found. Where the truth of the matter is, he found you. And Paul was saying that since he found you and bathed you in his mercy and in his grace, bathed us in his mercy and his grace, here's what we ought to do. I urge you, therefore, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice. Not dead sacrifice. No. Jesus was the only dead sacrifice that was good enough. when he died on the cross, that gift, offering, dead sacrifice. You notice that the Lord in the New Testament doesn't tell us to come to church with rams and bulls and goats and things of this nature. No, no. We are the sacrifice. One way of the sacrifice was supposed to be the temple of the Holy Spirit. Does the Holy Spirit really live in you? Yeah, well, if you say it, the Holy Spirit resides in you. And you carry him wherever you go. He hears everything I say. My innermost thoughts, God knows them. He knows me inside out. He knows more about me than you'll ever know. And there are some things that if you knew it about me, you'd quit talking to me. You'd clutch your purse when I walk past. You'd lock your door when you see me on the other side of the street. And trust me, there are some things about you too. But God, he looks beyond our faults. And he doesn't love us because of us. But he loves us in spite of all of these things. So Paul says that we ought to present our bodies as a living sacrifice. Living sacrifice. You owe God everything. Because you don't own anything. You own nothing. You know, you don't own a thing. Get that through your head. You don't own that car you drive. It's a loaner. That house you live in, it's a loaner. Those clothes that you have on your back, they're just lent to you. And we have a tendency to think because I got more money, because I live in a bigger house, I drive a newer car, and all of that, that I'm better. No. End of the day, you still just a pile of dirt. Just like the rest of us. And somebody else will get a chance to divvy up whatever you've accumulated. Report for duty daily. Present your bodies as living sacrifice daily. Present yourself daily. Not just on Sundays. And you know, Sundays is a real good day. We come in our holy hub. We get together and we look all holy. We all polished and cleaned up. We clean up our language, some of us. Yeah. And I don't know why we won't curse on Sundays. Excuse me. I said curse. Cuss. I don't know why we don't cuss on Sunday. It's just a wrong. You mean cussing on Monday any other day of the week. We clean up our act, you know, for a short period of time, one day a week. But the thing of it is, this ought to be a daily ritual with us. And it's not easy. And trust me, it is not easy. I try to start each day off asking God to lead me and to keep me so that I can be useful to him, so that I may glorify him, and then somebody cuts me off on the freeway. And I have to say, excuse me, Holy Spirit, we won't deal with this. I'll be back in just a minute. It ain't gonna take long. I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy that he has bestowed on all of us, that we offer our bodies as living sacrifices, holy and pleasing to God. I don't need to go in and explain that. That's self-explanatory. This is your true and proper worship. In the King James, it says your reasonable service. And when you go back and look at it in Koine Greek, it actually breaks down. It means your worshipful lives. Our lives are supposed to be full of worship. And the way we worship God is by the way that we conduct ourselves. I made a note. But that note says that people say what they think, but they do what they believe. Let that soak in. You say, we say what we think, but really, our actions really ferret out what we really believe. You can say, I'm a tither. You can even put tithing on the envelope. I'm going to meddle a little bit. But if you're not putting in a tenth, that's not a tithe. That's an offering. You know, the truth of the matter is, just because you say it's a tithe does not make it a tithe. And if you say that you are a tither, but you're not putting in what the tithe really is, you say what you think, but what you do really translate into who you are. Amen. So Paul says, our true and proper worship. Then he goes on to say, boy, this really slapped me all on both sides of my face. Don't conform to the pattern of this world. Don't walk in lockstep with this world. Don't conform to that. That's not our pattern. That's not our example. That's not our model. But we model ourselves after this world. We all do. And it's hard not to. It's hard not to be in step with everybody else around you. But he's saying that if we're going to live a worship-filled life, that we can't conform to the pattern of the world. And here again, that involves our thinking. It starts in the mind. That doesn't mean that you got to take a vow of poverty. Doesn't mean that you can't have nice things. Doesn't mean you can't dress nice. Doesn't mean that you can't have money. Doesn't mean any of those things. But what it does mean is that you can't let those things dictate your behavior. Don't conform to the pattern that this world is. And you know what? Our church has been so weak in our culture that the culture has impacted the church instead of the church impacting the culture. And you'll see it, officers, in your different ministries. You have to watch out. Be careful. Because the world will sneak in into the ministry. And when it sneaks into the ministry, guess what? It finds a good, comfortable place to reside in the congregation. And we have to be careful that we don't even model ourselves after any other congregation. Because some of our congregations get it all wrong. Church, I say this a lot because it's true. The church is a great social organization. Come here, nice people. They don't cuss all the time. They dress nice. They smell nice. Good food. Good music. That's good entertainment. That's good everything. And man, I tell you what, I would really miss the fellowship. That's not what church is about.
Come on, man.
We come here to refuel ourselves. We come here to mix it up with brothers and sisters so we can hone our skills so that when we're out in the world where we're really supposed to be putting this on display, that we are nonconformists. And if you are different, people will look at you, people will know it, they will, and they'll question you about it. Why are you so different than any and everybody else? If you don't believe me, just try it. Just try living according to the word. 1 week could probably be long enough. And in some instances, 1 day is long enough. I'm not bragging on myself, but I'm using this as an example. When I was just right out of Vietnam to come back and had a nice job to come back to, I made up my mind that I was going to go to college. Amen.
Amen.
Before I got drafted, I thought I was smart enough. I didn't need no college. But after I got through doing all that marching and shooting at people and digging or whatever, I came back and said, Lord, you let me go to school. I think I can. I had made up my mind that I was going to go to college. And so I was going to school at night. I was working at Western Electric at that time during the day. And in every evening, this was the constant routine for us to, once we got off work, everybody run down to the Union Hall because beer was cheap and they had a pool table. And all the guys would go and hang out at the Union Hall, shoot pool, drinking beer, and just, you know, just overall being guys. And I'd be stuck over in the corner reading a book. They said, man, every time we see you, you got your head stuck off in a book. I said, well, I'm trying to, you know, I want to go. I was not conforming. I was acting different. And it didn't take them long to spot. And when you decide that you're not going to conform to the pattern of the world, the world will call you into account. What's wrong with you? Amen. Enough said. And then he says, it's not like the guy at the convention. I was on to do a lecture. And this fellow sitting right on the front row, Brother Ingram. And I was up there doing my lecture, and he don't want to hear no lecture at the National Convention. They want to hear you hum and toot and boop. And I was up there reading and all said. And the fellow sitting on the front row said, why don't you preach? Because they put me on to do a lecture. You want to hear me preach, tell them put me on to preach. Then after I got through, he said, can I have a copy of that? That's what I tell him, no. You know, sit up there and put me on Front Street. Now you want to copy what I was saying. Now this next paragraph, gonna wrap it up, is really important. And not just for officers, and this message is not just for officers, this message is for all of us. All of us have something that we can take away from this. He says, verse 3, for by the grace given me, I say to every one of you, I say to all of us, do not think of yourself more highly than you ought. Now, it doesn't say that you can't think of yourself highly. Just don't think of yourself more highly than you ought to. We're all better than what we were when God first saved us. And so we've all moved up a notch. But if I think of myself more highly than I ought to, then that makes me, because God called me to preach, that invariably makes me better than you, which is not true. I need just as much of God's grace and mercy as anybody in this room. And if I ever act like I don't, then I'm out of bounds. Do not think of yourself more highly than you are. You know, I was intending to begin this message differently.
All right.
I was intending to say that we have a deficit in church leadership. We do. It's very truly, and it's probably at every church that's open. That may be very few of them that's got people standing in line saying, hey, I want to be the next president. I want to lead the... No, we have to get on the phone. And most of you, we beg you. Come on, now we need somebody to be the president. And that's not the way it's supposed to be. Everybody in here ought to be beaming with joy, looking for opportunities. How can I better serve God? And especially if God has gifted you with special gifts. But instead, we don't want to do it. And then as soon as we get somebody, some unfortunate soul, they finally say yes, you finally wear them down. Then the rest of us say, well, now how can we make this person fail? And that may not be what you're saying, but I'm telling you what you think. You may say, this is what I think, but your actions tell me something different. And I know what it needs to be set up for failure because I'm a moderator. Right? Yeah. And there's something wrong with that, and we've got to fix that. We've got to change that. We got a deficit in our teaching ministry here at True Leads. Nobody wants to teach. And especially as long as some of us, listen, I've been a member of this church almost, 65 years or better. Yeah. I've been a member of this church for a long time. And all that this church has invested in me, sending me to youth conferences, sending me to congresses, sending me here, there, and everywhere, I ought to be ready to stand up and say, yes, put me down. I will serve. But we go and get this information. And we just sit on it. And when it comes time to serve, we don't want to raise our hand and say, yes, I'll serve. And I'll give it my best. Nobody's asking you to be perfect. Nobody's asking that you will be the best. The only thing that God is expecting out of any of us is just do the best we can with what He has given us. And then I'm going to say on the other side of that coin, sometimes we can be real conceited. Sometimes you finally get that position to serve on the deacon board, or you finally get it, then you become God's gift to whatever. And ain't nothing gonna happen unless I say it's gonna happen, and it's gotta be the way I say it's gotta be, you know, because listen. By the grace of God, say to every one of you, don't think more highly of yourself than what you ought to, but rather think with sober judgment in accordance with the faith God has distributed to each of you. Be realistic when you think about yourself. Just because I have a master's degree in theology does not mean that I know everything. And it does not mean that I'm better than you. If it wasn't for the grace of God, I wouldn't have it. Amen. Lord knows how many nights I stayed up with tears in my eyes. Lord, just get me out of Hebrew. Now, you created this language. I don't know why you made it so confusing. You could have wrote the Bible in English, and then we wouldn't have to go through all of this. I prayed and asked God to get me out of Hebrew. Greek was, it was okay, but Hebrew, looked like somebody had dipped the chicken's feet in water and put it on paper. I mean, in paint. Put it on paper, and he just But God got me through that. And so I have to remind myself, I have to remember that. Anytime I want to get on my high horse, because I know the foreign language, I know the biblical language. At least I know how to interpret them. I know how to find the information. That make me better than you. I just have another skill that you don't have. Trust me, there are 10 more things that you can do better than me. So don't think of yourself more highly than you are. Judge your own self with sober judgment, in accordance to the faith that God has distributed to you. And then I'm wrapping this up. I'm getting through. This is it. For just as each of us has one body with many members, and he's using this as an example, these members do not all have the same function. So in Christ, we, though many, form one body. And each member belongs to all of them. I have to know that when you hurt, it hurts me.
Yeah.
It does. That's the way it works. That's when God's got it set up. When you hurt, I hurt. When you rejoice, then I ought to be joyful.
Yeah.
Each member belongs to all of the others. We have different gifts according to the grace given to each of us. If your gift is prophesying, then prophesy with the amount of grace that God has given you to exercise that gift. Don't let anybody stop you from prophesying. Now, don't get it twisted. There's a lot of stuff people call prophesying ain't nothing but junk. Preaching is a form of prophesying. The utterance of the word that's prophesied. All this other stuff, Paul said, is dumb. If it is serving, then serve. I've seen people try to discourage other people from serving, from exercising the gift that God gave them to serve. Everybody doesn't have the same gift. Everybody doesn't have the gift of giving. There's some people that can give and just give and give and give some more. And then there are other people, you got to pick them up, turn them upside down, shake them, then search all their pockets. They don't have the gift of giving. It doesn't come as easy to them as it does others. If it's serving, then and don't hamper somebody else because you're not doing it. Don't stop them. If it's a good thing, don't stop them from doing it. We had a little hiccup here in the community. We're still trying to work on it. But we got a church from North Dallas. Yet another church from North Dallas. That that's going to come to South Dallas. Well, we on Facebook, so I'm going. But it's going to come and show us how to do ministry in South Dallas. And the when the people come out to interview me, you know, I'm going to quit saying, you know, I'm going to start to learn how to say no. But when they came out to interview me, they said, what do you think? This church is want to come, and they want to do this, that, and the other, this, and this. And I said, well, why would I be against something like that? If they want to do the Lord's work, trust me, there is enough of the Lord's work that everybody can come on. Everybody can come aboard. But I did go on further to say, just so you will know exactly what I said. I said, but on the other hand, I have to question the motives of anybody that's got to sneak and do anything. If you have to come under the cover of darkness or you got to hide your hand, then I'm suspect of what your intentions are. And that's exactly what I said. Don't think that made the news was the last one. But I'm not against anybody doing the Lord's work. Jesus, his disciples came to him and said, Lord, there are people over there, they're casting out demons in your name, they're doing this and that. And we need to go and stop them. Jesus said, why? If they're doing it, in my name, then they're doing a good thing. If it's teaching, teach. If it's encouraging, then encourage. If it's giving, then give. If it's leading, do it diligently to show mercy. Do it cheerfully. The people that's not merciful, when it's come time to show it mercy, you need to step back and let the people that are merciful, let them not do that. Let them come to the forefront. Let them be. If it's encouraging, if that's not your spiritual gift, then let the encouragers come up and do the encouraging. That's all I'll say. We don't all have the same gift. But you can believe this, we do all have a gift. At least one. At least one. That there's something that God gave you that this congregation needs. And when you see the membership beginning to dwindle and whatever else, don't do like all these other churches, don't blame me. Because I'm told, it's your job. This membership is your job. Sheep begat sheep. If shepherds are begatting sheep, something is wrong with that picture. And we do it because we love him. We love him because he first loved us. Don't you know God really loves you? When you look at all the dirt and the scum and the grit and the grime and all of the mess that you've been through, because he was standing right there with you. Everywhere you go, you take him. But he loves you anyway. Yes, he assigned me an honor, sir. And I'm going to serve the Lord with gladness. Because he deserves it. He deserves it. That's right. Lord, we just want to say thank you for these people at this time in the history of the Truly Missionary Baptist Church, whose names have been called, and they answered the and now they find themselves serving as a president or a vice president, secretary, or an assistant. Whatever the position, there are no big positions, no little positions. We need them all. Yes. And so we ask your blessings on it. We know that it's going to be a gift of sacrifice. There's going to be times that they're going to be called upon to go and they really don't feel like going. They're going to have to set an example, something that maybe perhaps they really don't want to do, but because they have this title now, and people are looking at them and looking for leadership from them. There are times that they have to speak up when they really would rather be quiet, and there are times that they have to hold their tongue when they would really want to speak out. But Lord, only you can give them the power to do that. Help them to lead through your Holy Spirit. Help them to learn before they talk with their ministry that they talk with you. Help them to learn how to love your people like you love us. Help them to utilize whatever gifts that you have given them, use it to their fullest, to its fullest potential. If everything that we say and do as a ministry, as a congregation of people, help it to bring glory to your name. We don't want any credit. We don't deserve it. But we deserve a credit. We serve a credit deserving God. Because without you, there's nothing that we can do. Besides you, there is no other that we can call upon. And so since you have chosen to use us, help us that we may serve you in a manner that will be pleasing, that will meet your will, your good and perfect will. Help us to report for duty on a daily basis. Help us to present our bodies on a daily basis to serve you, because you are deserving of all of our praise, of all of our glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. There may be somebody that's here today. Maybe you are of the body of Christ for whatever reason. Thank you.